downstairs, we have started a series that is getting deeper. I encourage people to come because it will help us handle our own Christian life. It will help us handle our own brothers and sisters who are around us. Now sometimes we don't have to be the worst group of people, but we are in the worst position. Amen. Amen. So we've been standing on back, sliding over the time, and we are continuing this Wednesday after the youth are had their seminar in the morning hours. We are still running Bible studies. Amen. Amen. And on Fridays our communion service, and on Saturday is our communion prayer time. Amen. We want to say thank you to all of you again. Today, we are going to be teaching on the topic, the power of the focus. Please just bear with me, I'm not very strong, and I will just do what I can do. So I'll be a little bit slower. The power of the focus. The scripture was read by Pastor Scott, and I want us to go there. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. We want to start from verse 14. But I want to start from verse 12. Verse 12. Verse 12 says, not that I have already obtained or am already made perfect, but I press on. If that power is yours, you underline the word press on. But I press on. If it is so that I can take hold of that for which also I have been taken hold of by Christ Jesus. 13. Brothers, I do not regard myself as yet have taken hold. But one thing I do, that is our focus. But one thing I do, forgetting the things which were behind and stretch forward to the things which are before. Verse 14, I press on. The word I press on again just appeared. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. We bless you for this opportunity to share your word. Every heart that are open today, we pray, Lord, that your word will minister to them and that your word will find expression in those lives. We come against every contrary spirit and we declare, oh God, a free flow of your word. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
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 Amen. The scripture read is a testimony of one of the greatest apostles after the death of Jesus Christ. He wasn't an apostle walking with Christ, but he's one of the greatest of the apostles. That is Paul. Paul tells us that he doesn't, at this point in his life, he has planted some churches, he has gone places and been flocked. He had done some things and people didn't regard him for what he did. And he came to a point and said, it's not that I've attained or obtained what I already should have. But even if I establish some things and people are recognizing me for it, I don't count it a joy yet. Amen?
Amen.
And probably your life is a life that you've done some things for God. Everybody are hearing you around. And yourself, you think, I've done well. But like Paul, I want you to know that you haven't done anything. Amen?
Amen.
You haven't done anything because the life that is ahead of you is far better than the one you have already accomplished.
Hallelujah.
Probably you've been in a place of failure. You've been in a place of non-achievement. But I want to tell you that what you have above and beyond you or before you is far better than the failure life that you had.
Amen.
All of those things are in history. And the have a future, and the future can determine what you hold for the future or what you hold for your destiny. Amen?
Amen.
So God is saying that I don't believe in the past. I may have attained, I may have achieved, but that is not my focus. So I stop back to give you a few points on the power of being focused. The power of being focused. You know, every one of us, no one here is a mistake. No one here is a problem for God. You are God's chosen. No matter your age now, no matter when you got to know Christ, you are God's chosen.
Amen.
He knows and He trusts you and He believes in you. Yeah. Even though you don't believe in yourself, but He believes in you.
Amen.
Probably you have made some error with Him, but He still believes in you.
Amen.
That's why you need to be focused. And realize, first of all, that I've been called by God. I may not be doing the right thing now, but I still have the mark of God upon me.
Amen.
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 I may not get what I'm supposed to get or I'm opting to get, but I know I still have a future.
Amen.
What I thought that 2016 would have brought to me, I haven't gotten it, but I know that I still have a future.
Amen.
Things can get better
thank
if
you.
God is with you.
Amen.
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 So Paul stand like this and say, I have not got it, but one thing I do, I know there are challenges. I know there are people who will not like some of the things that you will do. In every aspect of life, no matter if you are doing bad things, you are doing good things, there are people who don't like you.
Uh-huh.
There are people who don't favor good people.
Yes.
There are people who don't know people who are doing something better. But still, don't look at them.
Amen.
Just be focused on what God has called you to
do.
That's the matter of life. Paul said, I don't want to know who has pointed their eyes on me, who has taken arrows towards me. One thing I do, I forget about all of them. And I press to the mark that will give me a goal, that will give me a price. No one has a price for you that is valuable than the price that God has for you. Because it is God who has called you to this race. It is not me who has called you to this race. So
Amen.
The matter of how you run this race is determined by God. It's not by men.
Amen.
You may fall many times. You may get up. But what you need to do, the Bible says in Hebrew that I keep my eyes on the future because He's the author and finisher of what I'm being called to and being available.
Thank you, Lord.
So, every one of us are called and given direct mission, given direct vision, given direct. You may not be called to build as a pastor, but you are called as an encourager to somebody.
Amen.
You may not be called as a preacher, but you are called to serve. That's your own place. So what you need to do is to first recognize that this is where I have to serve. I may not be as active as Pastor Okai. I may not be as active as the other bishops. I may not be as active as people around me. But I have one thing. And what I have, no one has that vision or no one has that same mission. All of these guys are pastors, but their missions are far different from mine.
Amen.
That's why I don't envy nobody.
Amen.
I'm just a unique person that I know God has called me to be.
Amen.
I'm just trying to play a compliment, to compliment people's efforts. So no matter how strong you are, don't look down on the other people. Keep focused on what you're called to do.
Thank you.
Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
So Paul said, I'm not looking at people's faults. I'm not looking at people's strength. I'm looking on what I'm called to do. I'm looking on what I'm called to do. I take you back to the Old Testament book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is a slave. He's taken in exile. And Nehemiah is taken there, but he had a dream and he had an expectation that one day I will go back home. One day I will go back to the place that God called me to be.
Mm-hmm.
So Nehemiah, all he had, he was serving in the king's palace.
Mm-hmm.
But that was not his vision. So one day he saw a brother who came back, and then he asked, what is about our hometown? What is about the vision that was given us? What is about the goal that we have? He said, it's all down to the ground. It take you, it take me, and take the other people to build it on me. I said, I will take the risk, and I will go back. So he went before the king whom he served. But this king knew that Nehemiah was always carrying joy. But this time, Nehemiah was not carrying a joy because something has happened to his vision. How do you feel when this church God has called you to, and the church is not on the right footing, or the vision that God has called you to is not on the right footing? How do you feel? Like Nehemiah. Nehemiah had bitterness. He had regret. So he entered the place. Even though he had lots of food, he had the opportunity to be before king. But his joy was stolen. Because his vision was not being followed up. His vision was not being followed up. When it hurts you, when you come to church, and people who are supposed to be in the church are not there, it doesn't hurt you. When people who are supposed to be around, and you see them going and they don't come, sorry, I'm bringing my backsliding message in your message today. What's your goal? What's your heart desire after that? So Nehemiah said, I must go back. And Nehemiah got back. Listen, every vision will have resistance. Mm-hmm. Every goal, everything, no matter what you are doing in life, there will always be opposition. Whether for good, whether for bad, there will always be opposition. Life is about positive and negative. But if you will succeed in the state of being positive or negative people around you, you must be focused.
Amen.
Only people that are focused will achieve their goals.
Amen.
Only people that are focused.
Thank you, Lord.
Will achieve their goals. So Nehemiah got to the place. He was giving plans to go back home to blow the wall. And Nehemiah got there. Nehemiah started the war by himself. The vision of God is giving you, don't need 5 million men. You don't need 3,000 persons to be a part of the vision. All you need to start.
Amen.
God who gave you the vision, God who gave you the mission, God who gave you the assignment will make the provision.
Amen.
It is not your business to worry about what you want to do now. Just start.
That's it.
God will bring the followers. God will bring the weapons.
Amen.
All you need to do now is to just be committed to what you have now.
Amen.
Nehemiah got there. He didn't tell anybody for 3 days. He took a tour around the city. He walked around the city and he's working. He didn't tell anybody, but by the time he decided to tell people, there were people who said, we will do all to help your vision. So Nehemiah is working, and in Nehemiah chapter 2, from verse 19, there came some guys. I said to you, every mission has resistance. Whether it's for a good purpose, listen, that was a purpose, a cause for people to hate, for people to bravo. But there were guys who were not happy because Nehemiah was building walls. They are always Tobias and Sabbath. They pretend that they are for you, but they are not. A man had come to rebuild the wall of the city of God. And Tobias and Sabbath decided to talk about them. How far would they go? My Bible put it against me in chapter 2, verse 19. They say, and Sabbath began to talk and said, what are these feeble Jews thinking of doing? Feeble Jews. Weak Jews. People may think you weak, but they are not the source provider of your strength.
Amen.
May tell you incapable or not qualified. You don't it that God has given you that vision, don't quit it.
Amen.
Your help comes from the Lord. All my help comes from the Lord. So Nehemiah is there, and he's working, and the guys trying to obstruct him. But Nehemiah kept focus. And the whole story concludes that Nehemiah ended his project.
Amen.
And they were brought to shame. Amen.
Amen.
Now, how can I focus on my greatest purpose? I'm talking about being focused. And I just talked about every one of us has the purpose of life. How then can I focus on this purpose? One. If this purpose must be achieved, if the focus must be permanent, one thing you need to do is to cut off ill relationship. Cut off ill relationship. People that will take you nowhere, people that will not add to you, you need to cut away from them. People that don't believe in your vision, you need to cut away. People that don't believe that you can make it, every time you share your dreams, every time you share your vision, and they give you the contrary, you need to be careful with them.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Cut off ill relationship. Ill relationship. In Psalm chapter 1, the whole chapter, it talks about blessed is the man who is not in the seat of his comfort, who is not standing in the way of the sinner and all of those, but his delights. That means God does not want you to have an ill relationship. All he needs is your relationship with him. Cut off ill relationship.
Amen.
I'm working on time. Number two. How to focus on your greatest purpose? We say, do not allow negative talk to derail your purpose. Do not allow negative talk to play sticker on you. Play sticker on you. Yesterday, my nephew and my son and one of their friends were in the car. They were lecturing on Prince Johnson being a pastor. And my nephew said he can't accept Prince Johnson being a pastor. He has a tag on Prince Johnson. He has a tag on Prince. But no matter your character, no matter who you are, let not the tag people have written about you or on you stop you from achieving your goal. You may have been the worst sinner, but there is still a turnaround for you.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
The Bible said we fall, but there is still a lifting. Yes. And when you get up, continue the race.
Hallelujah.
Don't let evil or negative thoughts stop you from reaching the greatest. No matter what they say about you, no matter the need they call you, just do the right thing.
Amen.
Just do the right thing.
Thank you.
Nehemiah chapter 2. Tobiah and Sambala said the feeble Jews and attacked the poor on them. Nehemiah has come from exile. He wasn't here. What have he come to do? He can't make it. How far will he go? But he kept focus. He kept his focus. In chapter 6, they wrote a letter to derail his purpose and said to him, come, let us have a meeting. There are times they will come and think they are coming in good faith. But they are only coming to distract you. Don't let people distract you from the vision. Don't let people distract you from the vision. There are some people who come in disguise. There are some people who come pretending to be for you, but they are against you.
that tomorrow you can explode somewhere, but they come and delay you so that you can't reach that place.
Thank you.
They come to be detractor. They come to make you foolish like them. There's a common saying, you mind the noise in the market. So close your ears to the spectre, No, I didn't come for a better God. I came to buy airplane. That's why I won in this market. Except you didn't make up your mind from your house. That's why you need to pray before you step out. You need to break through resistance. Break through resistance. No matter how tough it is, you break the way. And how God breaks the way, the Bible says in Isaiah, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. So if you will keep focused, you need to always wait on the Lord. You need to depend on God. Your human strength, your knowledge that you have acquired may take you places, but they have limitation. They have limitation. But God's strength can break limitation. That's why you need to wait on the Lord. To break through resistance, you need to wait on the Lord. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33, it says, But seek ye. The kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is righteousness. The kingdom of God is peace. The kingdom of God is holiness. The kingdom of God is truth. But seek ye the kingdom of God. And all other things. The detractors.
Thank you.
The backbiters. The backsliders. Your accusers. Will follow after you. Listen, nobody will like you because you are doing good. But God will force them to like you.
Amen.
Thank you.
If you speak with God, He said, I will make your enemies to bow. I will make, not you. You know, battles are won with right sources and right strategies. If you fight, you know, sometimes you see people, marriages are breaking because they are fighting in one enemy. Some of you want to change your husband and not your work. Some of you want to change your wives for your tits. Well, it is God who fits. He said, I will make.
That's thank you.
So you have crisis. You have battles that you are not winning. I want to fight it. To break through, you need to press. You need to keep. In James chapter 4, it says, submit to God. Submit to God. James chapter 4. You want the enemy to resist you? You want them to go far from you? Submit to God. To break through any resistance, submit to God. Then God will arise and fight your battle.
Amen.
I won't be secret to successful deliverance. Submit to God. If God be for you,
amen.
No one can be against you or even prevail.
Thank you.
Submit to God. Submit to God. To break through resistance, submit to God. In Jesus chapter 4, it says, submit to God, resist the devil. But we want to resist the devil before we submit. The first thing it says, submit to God, resist the devil, then he will flee. You know, sometimes we miss the calculation. error, what is up this one error?
Thank you. Do your work.
Point number four. I got 10 more minutes. Learn to use your time wisely. I come back to time. That's why I told you I got 10 more minutes. If you will remain focused and achieve your purpose, you must have respect for time. You must have respect for time. There are 24 hours allocated to all of us. It's not that the other guy has 62 hours in a day. The guys are achieving. The only thing, they plan their time and use their time well. Take for example, here you are. You went to town today. Probably you went to town to get something done. Let's take that a student. You went to town to get your class is by 12. And then you went to town by 10. And by the time you got on Broad Street, you have to go up the uphill to Ellen campus. And you go on Broad Street, you met a friend and you didn't plan in your day. Eva, you got a section today. And you left section 2. Or the Christian. Eva, we got one prayer meeting that was supposed to go to. Is the prayer meeting in your schedule for that day? Let me talk to Christians now. Say, you don't love God. I misuse of time. Don't tell me, Pastor, what's wrong? I didn't plan to go to that prayer meeting. I planned to go to town by 12 to be to my class. And by the time you miss your class, then the teacher say you need to pay money. Say the teacher, wicked, you've been wicked. Yeah. I'll not give your test again. You've been wicked to yourself. Use your time well to get your goals achieved.
Amen. Thank you.
Play your time, use it well. Don't be the all-around Jack Jim Tech. I know when to be to places. If I will be out of my house 8 o'clock, it means I'm to this church. 8 o'clock does not meet me in the streets. My family must see me 8 o'clock. Sorry, some of you probably have not answered your call after 10. My family needs me. Not just use my time anyhow. Because I have a goal and I want to achieve. Learn to use your time wisely. And lastly, if you achieve your greater purpose or goal, you must know who your advisors are.
That's a word.
Know who your advisors are. Know who your advisors are. Only a good plow. Know who your advisors are.
Thank you.
First Kings chapter 12. I will not read the whole story. First Kings chapter 12, it is funny seeing a plant in 2 Chronicles chapter 10. There is this king by the name of Rehoboam. He gets up and he's raising to the place of king. And his father dealt with the people harshly. And for that reason, his reign was not successful. And when he got on the throne, the elders came to him and said, "My son, if you have a small reign, you need to reduce some of the weights that your parent or your father placed on the people. You need to put some smooth operation in the kingdom." Sarah gave me 3 days. Gave me 3 days. And you come back from results. When he called the elderly advisors in the kingdom, they came and told him, "My son, this is where we've been, and this is how we think you need to run and be smooth." Sarah, I'm glad. Then he sent for a crowd, a BS. I'm not saying young people remember, you are thinking about being married as a young lady. You go to a married woman to advise you. You go to one scrap, one scrape up, one thing for the desktop.
Cautious of your advisor. God bless you. You will have a wonderful week.